Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Hello friends, welcome to this lecture series of BSc with Chemistry, discipline specific elective of quantum chemistry, spectroscopy and photochemistry. In this lecture, we will see the vibrational spectroscopy. Now friends, the vibrational or infrared spectra appears when transitions are induced among the vibrational energy levels, and that too due to the absorption of energy radiations in the spectral range of say 500 to 4000 centimeter inverse. And hence this is also called as infrared spectra. Now it appears due to the change in dipole moment and due to the vibrations or oscillations in the molecule. If basically the excitation energy is sufficiently large to cause the transition from one vibrational energy level to the another in the same electronic level, that results in the vibrational spectra of the molecule. You can see in this figure, herein the black line indicates the electronic region or electronic state. This is the ground electronic state, this is excited electronic state. These blue lines in the electronic states, they indicate the respective vibrational states, and the orange line, they indicate the rotational levels. Now when this transition takes place from this one blue line to other blue line in the same electronic state, the vibrational spectra appears. Now the energy is required for these spectra. Basically these are available in the infrared region of the electromagnetic spectrum, and hence this spectra is also known as IR spectra or mid IR spectra or near IR spectra. Now this type of spectra is shown by only those molecules which possesses permanent dipole moment, or by the molecules whose vibrational motion is accompanied by a change in dipole moment. Now the homonuclear diatomic molecule like oxygen, nitrogen, chlorine, hydrogen, they all have zero dipole moment and therefore they do not show IR spectra. Moreover, the polyatomic molecules like CO2 may or may not have permanent dipole moment, but when they are subjected to IR radiations, they induce the oscillating dipole moment, and in such polyatomic molecules, they show vibrational spectra. As such, we already have seen that the energy required for the rotational transition is much, much lower than the vibrational transitions. And hence, the vibrational transitions is usually accompanied by the rotational transitions. And such spectra is also called as vibrational rotational spectra. Now in case of liquids, if you see, the rotational motion is quenched due to intermolecular interactions, and hence pure vibrational spectra can be observed in such cases. Now in order to understand the vibrations in diatomic molecule, we assume that the vibrational motion is simple harmonic motion and the molecule is actually simple harmonic oscillator. You can see here these balls, they are performing the simple harmonic motion like this pendulum. Now a simple harmonic oscillator is the one in which they oscillates under the action of restoring force. What I mean by this is the displacement is in opposite direction so as they should reach to the equilibrium position. Now this restoring force is actually proportional to the displacement from the mean position or the equilibrium position, which is given by the Hooke's law. Now you can see in this equation number one, the Hooke's law is given. And we have seen here, we can see here that this F is equal to minus Kx, where K is this force constant and X is actual displacement. Now for such an oscillator energy, the change in this energy, that is dE, for a small displacement of dx, we can write down dE is equal to minus F dx, or we can similarly write down that dE is equal to dE is equal to Kx into dx. So if we integrate this, we can have this E is equal to half kx square, and which is going to give us the energy for this vibrational spectra. Now friends, based on this expression, we can make several assumptions. This equation number 3 is actually the equation of parabola. And so the value of energy changes with the displacement in a parabolic manner. Now you can see in this figure here, the change in potential energy with respect to displacement. If we plot, it gives the parabolic structure. Now at equilibrium, say we have x is equal to 0, and therefore the potential energy is also 0. And in this case, the increase in potential energy is continuous. However, according to quantum mechanics, the vibrational energy levels are quantized, and therefore the energy is given by particularly this expression. This EV is equal to V plus half into H nu. Now in this, we know that this V is the vibrational quantum number, which has only integral values like 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. H is the Planck's constant and nu is the vibrational frequency or the oscillating frequency, which is given by this. And we can calculate from this the wave number. Now, this is actually the equilibrium frequency in terms of wave number. And therefore, we can substitute this value over here and we can find out this expression for the energy, vibrational energy. Now, we can make the further important conclusion from these equations. Basically, now putting the different values of vibrational quantum number in this expression, we get different energy levels. And we can see that these are the energy levels E0, E1, E2, wherein half hc omega e, 3 by 2 hc omega e, 5 by 2 hc omega e. We can see here. We can go on predicting like this. And hence, actually each two vibrational energy levels are separated by equal amount of energy. So for example, for V is equal to 0, this energy is called as zero point energy. Or this is what I'm aiming at. This is zero point energy. Now, what is this zero point energy? It is actually that minimum amount of energy which is associated with a vibrating molecule. Now, this energy exists with a molecule even at absolute zero of temperature, when all other forms of energy becomes actually zero. And therefore, this is the zero point energy. Now, if you try to see the selection rules for pure vibrational spectra, the first and foremost condition for getting vibrational spectra is that the dipole moment of molecule must change due to vibration. Because unless the dipole moment change, we cannot get the vibrational spectra. The molecule need not have the permanent dipole moment, but the change in dipole moment should not be zero. That is what is the first and foremost condition. And secondly, the change in vibrational quantum number should be unity. Both the conditions are written over here. Now, if we try to see the pure vibrational spectra of simple harmonic oscillator, according to selection rule, the vibrational transitions are allowed only between the adjacent energy levels. And also, each of the two energy levels are separated by equal amount of energy, and which are given by this particular expression, if we try to see the difference. Isn't it? And therefore, we will get only one line in the vibrational spectrum of simple harmonic oscillator. Isn't it? And that particular frequency in wave number of the line which corresponds to the fundamental vibrational frequency of the oscillator. Basically, that particular frequency is the wave number corresponding to that is omega e. And the frequency in wave number of the line of the fundamental vibrational frequency is corresponding to omega e. Basically, at room temperature, most of the molecule exists in the ground vibrational state, which we call it as V is equal to zero. And hence, only transition of the interest is from V is equal to zero to V is equal to one. This transition is called as the fundamental transition. And the frequency corresponding to it is called as fundamental vibrational frequency. That is what is displayed over here. Now, if you try to see the vibrational energy levels in anharmonic oscillator, what we have seen that in case of harmonic oscillator, the atoms comes back to the equilibrium position from any distance, But it is not the case with the real molecule. If two bonded atoms are stretched to such a large separation that the restoring force decreases and the molecule dissociate. This is such that the molecule dissociation takes place, and therefore it is not harmonic oscillation, and therefore we call it as anharmonic oscillations or anharmonic oscillator. P.M. Moores studied the effect of stretching on vibrational energy of the molecule, and he put forward an equation which is called as Moore's equation, and this equation is given by this expression, where we know that this dE is the dissociation energy of the molecule, r is the internuclear distance at any position, and re is the equilibrium distance. Now, the Moore's potential curve is basically shown here. You can see this is the Moore's potential curve. When we apply the Schrodinger wave equation, and when we try to solve this using the Schrodinger wave equation, the value of potential energy, if we take from this particular Moore's equation, the vibrational energy levels are given by this expression. Now, if you see here, this is the original expression minus this particular term is involved over here. And therefore, it can be seen that the separation of the two energy levels is less by this particular factor, isn't it? In this factor, this Xe is called as the anharmonicity constant. And therefore, as compared to harmonic oscillator, the energy will always be less by particularly this factor. Now, as the value of vibrational quantum number goes on increasing, this separation subsequently goes on decreasing. And hence, the energy levels are not equally spaced, but they fall closer and closer as the energy increases. And finally, the energy becomes continuous. You can see here, the energy becomes continuous almost in this region, and we obtain the continuum kind of region. Thus, the conclusion is various transitions are possible from V is equal to 0 to V is equal to 1, V is equal to 0 to V is equal to 2, V is equal to 0 to V is equal to 3, etc. And we can get the bands of transition. When we get the different bands in the spectrum, the most intense band will be that of the transition from V is equal to 0 to V is equal to 1. This is due to the fact that the greater population of molecules are always are lying in the ground vibrational level, that is 0 point energy level, that is V is equal to 0 level, and this particular intense band is called as fundamental vibrational band, isn't it? And further, the absorption corresponding to this is called as fundamental absorption. Now further, we get the weak intensity band corresponding to the transition from V is equal to 0, and which is called as first overtone band, and extremely weak band corresponding to the transition from V is equal to 0 to 3, it appears, and which is called as second overtone. And this particularly, this dark line corresponds to the energy curve of anharmonic oscillator, and which we called as Moore's potential curve. And this dashed line is actually the ideal one, which is the energy curve for simple harmonic oscillator. This is the dissociation energy line, and this distance is equilibrium distance, whereas from this equilibrium distance it increases and it decreases further, and it has been plotted against the potential energy. Further, if you try to see the vibrational rotational spectra, now pure vibrational spectra can be observed only in liquid cases where the rotational motion is inhibited by the intermolecular interactions. Now, in case of gaseous state, the molecules are rotating continuously, irrespective of their vibrational state, and the energy required for rotational transition is extremely small as compared to the vibrational transition. And therefore, the vibrational transitions are invariably accompanied by the rotational changes. Now, such gaseous molecules give basically the rotational vibrational spectra, and the energy of vibrating rotor is given by the sum of vibrational energy and rotational energy, which can be seen over here. It can be represented like this. Okay, and we also know that this E is equal to hc into nu bar, which is wave number, and we can replace this expression with this. We can find out this expression. We can subsequently come to this expression. Now, substituting these values of vibrational and rotational quantum number, wave number, we can arrive at this expression wherein there is the cognizance of rotational part as well as vibrational part, isn't it? Now, since most of the molecules are in ground vibrational state, and if you consider a vibrational rotational transition from say V is equal to 0 to V is equal to 1, which is accompanied by the rotational transition from J to say further J dash, the first rotational level, the wave number corresponding to this transition is basically given by this particular expression. Isn't it? And basically, if you try to see this expression, we can see the transition from J to J dash rotational quantum number and V is equal to 0 to V is equal to 1. Now, if you further solve it, we arrive at this particular expression. Now, putting this value of omega 0, we arrive at this. So, basically, with this transition, with this, we can obtain the two expressions for, say, delta J is equal to plus 1 and delta J is equal to minus 1. So, for delta J is equal to plus 1, the transition will have the value omega 0 plus 2b into j plus 1, and for delta j is equal to minus 1, we will have omega 0 minus 2b into j dash plus 1, where this j and j dash can have values from 0, 1, 2 and so on, isn't it? And we can have now the bands which are produced due to this kind of transitions. So we have seen that vibrational rotation lines are obtained at positions given by these equations. So we have got these two equations now, and with the help of these two equations, we can see in this figure very important conclusions can be drawn. Now, if you see firstly that the no lines will be obtained at basically this part omega zero, and this particular wave number is called as the band center or band origin, isn't it? And particularly this frequency is called as fundamental frequency, because this is at origin. And secondly, now if you now put the values of say J is equal to 0, 1, 2 and so on, we get various equally spaced lines with the spacing of 2b. You can see here 2b, 2b, 2b on this side, 2b, 2b, 2b on this side, isn't it? And also, now if you see for say for delta J is equal to minus 1, what we will get? We will get lines with the frequency which will be lower than the fundamental frequency, and this group of lines is called as P branch. This is particularly the region, if you see here, isn't it? And subsequently, say for delta J is equal to plus 1, now we get the lines with the frequency higher than that of the fundamental frequency, and this group of lines is called as R branch of the spectrum, that is of this side, isn't it? For delta J is positive in this side, and obviously for delta J is equal to 0, that is for the purely vibrational spectrum, we should get lines at the fundamental frequency, that is at this region. Okay, so this group of lines is called as Q branch of the spectrum. You can see over here, isn't it? And this branch is not observed particularly in vibrational rotational spectrum, and this particularly observes or appears in only purely vibration spectrum. Although there is an exception of nitric oxide in this case, say delta J is actually the forbidden for all the diatomic molecule, but there is only one exception to this case is nitric oxide, where one would observe the Q branch as well. So if you try to see the applications of vibrational rotation spectra, from this vibrational rotation spectra, it is very much possible to calculate the distance between each two lines in P or R branch. And since we know that the separation is 2B, and also this B is related to the moment of inertia, because we know that this B is H upon 8 pi square IC. And therefore, I can very easily calculate from this equation the distance between the two molecules, or distance, molecular distance. Now, since I is related to bond length, and I is actually equivalent to mu into I, R square, so I can calculate very easily the bond length of the molecule. Another application of the vibrational spectroscopy is that the calculation of force constant becomes easier, because this force constant is related to vibrational frequency, and because you can see this particular expression wherein we can see this force constant is related to vibrational frequency, and with this expression we can calculate this force constant. Now, knowing the values of this wave number, reduced mass, it is always possible to find out the constant for a particular bond, that is K. We have this formula. So this is all about the theory part of this particular spectra. Now friends, based on this knowledge, let us try to find out degrees of freedom and the normal modes of vibration. Now, the number of variables required to locate all the atoms in a molecule is called as degree of freedom. Say for a single atom, there are only three variables that are required to locate it, isn't it? However, for a polyatomic molecule, the things are little different. And that too, if we consider a polyatomic molecule containing n number of atoms, the total number of degrees of freedom will become 3 into n, that is 3n. Now, these degrees of freedom include the translational, vibrational, and rotational degrees of freedom. And the degrees of freedom of a molecule, it plays a very important role in determining the normal modes of vibration. And also, the number of fundamental bands of absorption, if you try to see, it plays a vital role. Now, normal mode of vibration is actually defined as, which is given over here, it is actually defined as a molecular motion in which all the atoms in the molecule vibrate with the same frequency and all the atoms pass through their equilibrium position simultaneously. So based on this, if I try to classify the polyatomic molecules, I can classify it on two categories. One is nonlinear and the other is linear. If you try to see, the total degrees of freedom in case of this nonlinear molecule is 3n. And in this nonlinear molecule, we also need to consider the translational degrees of freedom, that is 3. The rotational degrees of freedom, that is 3. And therefore, the vibrational degrees of freedom will automatically will become 3n minus 3 for translational, 3 for rotational, that has to be subtracted. And therefore, we get 3n minus 6 vibrational degrees of freedom. And hence, the nonlinear molecule has 3n minus 6 normal modes of vibration. And so, 3n minus 6 fundamental bands of absorption, basically. Similarly, if I try to see the linear molecule, again, the total degrees of freedom is 3n. And the translational degrees of freedom is 3. The rotational degrees of freedom in this case is 2 because the molecule is linear, isn't it? And therefore, the vibrational degrees of freedom will be 3n minus 3 minus 2, and therefore it is 3n minus 5. And hence, a linear molecule has 3n minus 5 normal modes of vibration, isn't it? And that is actually will give me fundamental bands of absorption in this case. Now, similarly, if I try to find out the normal modes of vibration of the triatomic molecule, how many number of ways in which such molecules, they can give the vibration. So the number of vibrational degrees of freedom, which we can calculate from the molecule corresponding to the normal modes of vibration, we can see here, say suppose we consider the triatomic molecule, there can be vibrations of two types. One is stretching vibration, and this type of vibration arises because there is a stretching and contracting of the bonds without producing any change in the bond angles. What I want to say is the distance between two atoms increases or decreases, but the atom remains on the same bond axis. That is what is the meaning. Now there are two types of stretching vibrations. One is symmetric stretching and another is asymmetric stretching. That is what is given over here. Now in case of symmetric stretching, you can see that in this type of stretching, the moment of bonded atoms is in the same direction with respect to the central atom. That is, both the bonded atoms move towards or away from the central atom simultaneously. Whereas in case of asymmetric stretching, if you see, one atom approaches to the central atom, whereas the other atom approaches away from it. We have tried to show here this kind of motion. And hence, both the stretching and vibrations become infrared active. However, this symmetric stage does not change the dipole moment of the linear molecule, and so it becomes the infrared inactive. Similarly, for bending vibrations, if we try to see the possible number of ways we have, there can be four types of bending vibrations. Now, in these bending vibrations, there is a deformation of bond angle and there is no change in the bond length. The one way is scissoring, another way is rocking, third way is wagging, and fourth way is twisting. If you see here, in all of them, say in scissoring, in this type of vibration, the two atoms approaches in the same plane. In rocking, the vibration, the movement of atoms occurs in the same direction and also in the same plane. In wagging, if you see here, the vibration of two atoms moves up and down in the plane with respect to the central atom. And in twisting, if you see, the one of the atom moves up in the plane, whereas the other moves down in the plane with respect to the central atom. This is what is bending vibration. If you further try to see the vibrations in water molecule, we can have 3N minus 6, that is equal to three modes of vibrations: symmetric stretching, symmetric bending, and asymmetric stretching. Now, if you try to see here, out of these three modes, all of the three modes are accompanied by change in dipole moment. And all of them, they are IR active. And also they require the different energies, and therefore all of them, they are non-degenerated, isn't it? This table basically gives the glimpse of the application of vibration spectroscopy in detection of functional group in organic compounds, or the functional groups in organic compounds. And basically they contain fixed atoms with the definite bond lengths. And these bonds, they undergo stretching and bending vibrations when basically subjected to IR radiation, and hence they absorb at definite wave numbers. These wave numbers can be used to identify their functional groups, and usually it is a signature kind of thing. And therefore, like in alcohol, the OH stretch is in between this particular wave number. CO stretch is in between this particular wave number. Ethers, aldehydes, ketones, carboxylic acid. Specifically, in carboxylic acid, the CO stretch will be 1732 1700, and therefore with this signature you can actually identify the presence of these particular functional groups in the organic compounds, like for esters, acid chlorides, anhydrides, amines, amides. Similarly, you can further see this as in alkyl halides, ketonic group, NH band, primary NH band, nitriles, isocyanates, mercaptans. You can predict many of these functional groups in the organic compounds based on this signature spectra. So now, basically, from the knowledge of this vibrational frequency of functional groups, as we have seen in the earlier tables, we can identify the organic compound, the functional groups present in the organic compounds particularly. Why I am saying like this? Because in this spectroscopy, particularly the spectrum which we obtain represents actually the fingerprint of this particular molecule. And therefore, many a times this IR spectroscopy is known as fingerprint spectroscopy or fingerprint spectra, in which we can, particularly in olden days, nowadays there are many techniques through which we can identify the functional groups, and for organic chemists the job is little bit easier right now. However, in earlier times, old days, this was the golden tool to identify the organic functional groups which are present with the compounds. And it can be find out with the help of this table, with which we can actually figure out what functional group is present at what frequency level. One of the example is tried to present over here of the hexanoic acid. If you that way try to see in the example, and the particular figure represents the IR spectrum of the hexanoic acid. Now, if you look at this figure, there are CH2 bending modes at around, say, 1500 degrees, 1500 centimeter inverse. There is a strong ketonic peak around 1700 centimeter inverse. There is a medium CO peak around 1250 centimeter inverse. And basically, the sp3 CH and OH stretching mode are basically less clear herein. So, if you see here, at first, the OH peak appears to be absent, basically, if you look at it at the first sight, and the CH stress appears to be very broad. The reason for this is actually the wide peak between 3000 to 2600 centimeter inverse is really the usual CH stretch with the broad OH stretch superimposed on it. And basically, the low frequency vibration of this OH bond is related to the partial dissociation of the proton due to the strong hydrogen bonding. And that is the reason why we obtain this peak, sharp peak at the end, and a broader region herein. So there is a superimposing image of this particular peak. So this way we can find out the spectrum of many of the organic compound having the functional groups, and we can attempt in predicting which kind of functional group is present at what position. And you can guess what is the compound containing the, or what is the functional group containing the compound. And we can predict many more compounds like this. So herein, we would stop here. So friends, this is the end of lecture 13. Thank you very much.